ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। सो टुडे एज यू नो विल बी स्टार्टिंग आवर स्टडी ऑफ दी सांख्य फिलोसफी। इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फिलोसफी एंड वन ऑफ दी ओल्डेस्ट। सो स्पेशली फॉर अंडरस्टैंडिंग द गीता, मेनी टर्म्स विच विल ऑकर इन द गीता एंड ऑफकोर्स सम ऑफ द उपनिषद्स ऑल्सो, स्पेशली द श्वेताश्वतर उपनिषद। वी हैव टू नो द मीनिंग्स ऑफ द टर्म्स विच ऑकर देयर, लाइक प्रकृति, महत, गुणा, अव्यक्त। ऑल दीज टर्म्स आर रिलेटेड टू द सांख्य फिलोसफी। सो इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फिलोसफी एंड लिटिल डिटेल्ड स्टडी इज रिक्वायर्ड। ऑफकोर्स वी वोंट गो इन टू मच डिटेल, ओनली एज मच एज इज एब्सोल्युटली रिक्वायर्ड फॉर अंडरस्टैंडिंग द गीता एंड अदर स्क्रिप्चर्स। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट, बिकॉज सिंस इट इज अ वेरी ओल्ड एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट फिलोसफी, वी शुड हैव अ लिटिल आइडिया ऑफ दिस बिफोर गोइंग इन टू द स्क्रिप्चर्स प्रॉपर। सो फर्स्ट अबाउट द फाउंडर ऑफ दिस फिलोसफी, इट इज सपोज टू बी द वर्क ऑफ अ ग्रेट सेज बाय द नेम ऑफ कपिल, कपिल मुनि। एंड सांख्य इज अ वेरी ओल्ड सिस्टम ऑफ थॉट, सो इट्स एंटिक्विटी अपियर्स फ्रॉम द फैक्ट दैट द सांख्य टेंडेंसी ऑफ थॉट परवेड्स ऑल, नियरली ऑल द लिटरेचर ऑफ एंशियंट इंडिया, इंक्लूडिंग द श्रुतिज, दैट इज द वेदास, द स्मृतिज लाइक द पुराणास एंड द गीता एंड अदर वर्क्स ऑल्सो। सो लॉट ऑफ प्रेज हैज बीन शावर्ड ऑन द सांख्य फिलोसफी बाय आर सेंट्स एंड सेजेस। इट इज सच अ फिलोसफी रिस्पेक्टेड बाय ऑल। इन द महाभारत इट इज सेड देर इज नो नॉलेज लाइक सांख्य एंड नो पावर लाइक दैट ऑफ योगा। इन सच वर्ड्स इट हैज बीन प्रेज्ड, नास्ति सांख्य समम ज्ञानम, देर इज नो ज्ञान और नॉलेज न अस्ति लाइक सांख्य एंड नास्ति योग समम बलम, देर इज नो पावर लाइक दैट ऑफ योगा। सो सच प्रेज हैज बीन शावर्ड ऑन दी सांख्य फिलोसफी इन द महाभारत। एंड अनदर थिंग इज दिस फिलोसफी इज वेरी क्लोज, वेरी अकिन टू वेदांता। अ पर्सनैलिटी लाइक शंकराचार्य सेज दैट, आई कोट, दिस डॉक्ट्रिन स्टैंड्स समवट नियर टू वेदांत सिंस लाइक द लैटर इट एडमिट्स द नॉन डिफरेंस ऑफ कॉज एंड इफेक्ट एंड मोर एवर इट हैज बीन एक्सेप्टेड बाय सम ऑफ द ऑथर्स ऑफ द धर्म सूत्रस such as Devala and so on. So Devala and other figures are very prominent figures in the Indian mythology. So all these people have accepted Sankhya and for regarding the theory of cause and effect, which we will study today, that is called Satkaryavada, both Sankhya and Vedanta hold the same view. So very important philosophy. Now let us see how the word Sankhya is derived. एस जनरली इट इज स्पेल्ड समटाइम्स एस ए एम के एच वाई ए, समटाइम्स ऑल्सो इट इज स्पेल्ड लाइक एस ए एन के एच वाई ए. एनी वे द प्रोनाउंसिएशन इज सांख्य एंड देर अ वेरी सिमिलर वर्ड इन संस्कृत दैट इज संख्या. संख्या मीन्स नंबर. सो वन व्यू इज दैट सांख्य इज डिराइव फ्रॉम द वर्ड संख्या. संख्या इज नंबर बिकॉज वेन वी विल स्टडी द एवोल्यूशन, थ्योरी ऑफ एवोल्यूशन अकॉर्डिंग टू सांख्य, देयर वी विल सी दैट प्रकृति स्लोली इवॉल्व्स इन टू दिस वर्ल्ड. ऑल द एलिमेंट्स विच वी नो अकॉर्डिंग टू सांख्य दे आर डिराइव फ्रॉम प्रकृति. सो दिस संख्या और नंबर मे ऑल्सो रिलेट टू द काउंटिंग ऑफ दीज प्रिंसिपल्स बॉर्न आउट ऑफ प्रकृति. बट अनदर मीनिंग ऑफ दिस मीनिंग ऑफ सांख्या इज नॉलेज. सो दैट इज वॉट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर अस हियर. सांख्या मीन्स नॉलेज और परफेक्ट नॉलेज दैट इज डिवाइन नॉलेज. सो इट मीन्स नॉलेज ऑफ द सेल्फ थ्रू राइट डिस्क्रिमिनेशन. दैट इज द सुप्रीम नॉलेज ऑफ द सेल्फ और पुरुष अकॉर्डिंग टू सांख्या. सो करेक्ट नॉलेज ऑफ दैट थ्रू डिस्क्रिमिनेशन. डिस्क्रिमिनेशन बिटवीन वॉट? डिस्क्रिमिनेशन बिटवीन प्रकृति एंड पुरुष. सो ऑल दीज वी विल स्टडी. एंड एज आई वॉज टेलिंग दैट मेनी रेफरेंसेज टू सांख्य आर फाउंड इन आवर एंशंट स्क्रिप्चर्स. लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन द छांदोग्य उपनिषद वी फाइंड द मेंशन ऑफ ऑल दीज थ्री गुणस लाइक सत्व रजस एंड तमस वेरी वेल एक्सप्लेन्ड इन द छांदोग्य उपनिषद्स. एंड दी सांख्य कैटेगरीज विच वी विल स्टडी लेटर, महत बुद्धि अहंकार ऑल दीज दे आर मेंशन्ड इन दी कठ उपनिषद. एंड श्वेताश्वतर उपनिषद स्पेशली फोकसेस ऑन द सांख्य बिकॉज इट क्लियरली मेंशन्स द सांख्य कैटेगरीज. एक्चुअली इन द श्वेताश्वतर उपनिषद द वर्ड सांख्य एंड कपिला हैव बीन यूज्ड फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम. सांख्य एंड कपिला दीज वर्ड्स ऑकर फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम इन द श्वेताश्वतर उपनिषद. एंड इन द सेम उपनिषद वी सी दैट वर्ड्स लाइक व्यक्ता, व्यक्ता मीन्स मैनिफेस्टेड, अव्यक्त मीन्स अनमैनिफेस्ट, ऑल दीज आर फाउंड. एंड दीज वर्ड्स लाइक प्रधान प्रकृति एंड गुणा आर ऑल्सो फाउंड देयर. प्रधान इज अनदर नेम फॉर प्रकृति. इट इज प्रकृति इज ऑल्सो नोन एज प्रधान. सो ऑल दीज रेफरेंसेज आर देयर इन दी उपनिषद्स. सो फ्रॉम दैट वी नो दैट इट इज अ वेरी वेरी एंशंट फिलोसफी. एंड द फाउंडर वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन इज सेज कपिला. सो अकॉर्डिंग टू ट्रेडिशन द फर्स्ट वर्क ऑफ द सांख्य स्कूल इज द सांख्य सूत्र ऑफ कपिल. इट इज सेड दैट कपिल रोट दिस वर्क सांख्य सूत्र. सूत्र इज यू नो अफोरिजम्स. सो लाइक द ब्रह्म सूत्रस दीज आर ऑल्सो स्मॉल अफोरिजम्स. बट एज वी नो विदाउट एनी एक्सप्लेनेशन दीज अफोरिजम्स और सूत्रस आर वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू अंडरस्टैंड. सो वी आर टोल्ड दैट कपिल हिमसेल्फ रोट एन इलेबोरेट वर्क एंटाइटल्ड दी सांख्य प्रवचन सूत्र इन विच ही एक्सप्लेन्ड दो सूत्रस विच ही हिमसेल्फ हैड रिटन. सो बट अनफॉर्चुनेटली वी डोंट दीज वर्क्स आर नॉट अवेलेबल नाउ. देर इज अ बुक पब्लिश्ड नोन एज दी सांख्य सूत्रस बट nobody knows whether it is authentic or not. In fact, generally its authenticity is doubted. So unfortunately, it is very difficult to say whether this work which is extant now, Sankhya Sutras, is genuine or not. Most probably it is not. So we can say, I think, that the original works of Kapila has been lost. We don't have it. Now after Kapila came his disciple Asuri, and after Asuri came Asuri's disciple called Panchashikha. So Panchashikha wrote some books which aimed at a clear and elaborate exposition of the Sankhya system. But unfortunately, Panchashikha's works have also been lost in course of time. So now actually the only authoritative work which is available on Sankhya is Ishwara Krishna's Sankhya Tattva Kaumudi. This is what people study, and this is what we have also studied when we were in Belur Math training center. So Sankhya, this Tattva Kaumudi of Ishwara Krishna, and it has a very beautiful commentary on it by Vachaspati Mishra. So these sutras have been, you know, commentated upon by many people, and one of the most important commentaries on this is by Vachaspati Mishra. You know, Vachaspati Mishra has a very special place in Indian philosophy. He is the only person who has written commentaries on books on all the six systems of Indian philosophy. This is the greatness of that person. So actually Vachaspati Mishra is called Sarva Tantra Swatantra. Tantra means philosophy. Swatantra means he is free. He is not bound to any philosophy. His work on Vedanta, his commentary on the Brahma Sutras is so important. And he has written a wonderful commentary on the Yoga Sutras also. And Sankhya, we have seen that he has written a commentary. So all these six systems of philosophy, such a genius, it is very, very rarely seen. So Vachaspati Mishra, this name we should remember, a very important personality, a great personality. So actually it is his commentary on the Sankhya Tattva Kaumudi which is now studied and which is referred to when people want to know anything about this philosophy. Okay, so we have seen what the Sankhya means. Actually the origin of the term Sankhya is shrouded in mystery. Some people say that Sankhya is an adaptation from Sankhya, number, which we have already seen, and this has been applied to this philosophy because it aims at a right knowledge of reality by the enumeration of the ultimate objects of knowledge. But a more plausible explanation, and which we should give importance to, is that the word Sankhya means Samyak Jnana. Jnana is knowledge. Samyak Jnana is perfect knowledge. So Sankhya means perfect knowledge, and a philosophy which gives us such knowledge is therefore called Sankhya. So Sankhya will mean perfect knowledge, and because this means perfect knowledge, the philosophy which gives us this knowledge is also called Sankhya. Such is the importance of Sankhya philosophy. And we have already seen in our introduction to the Indian philosophical systems, we have already seen that all all the branches of Indian philosophical systems have only one aim, one practical purpose. What is that? Putting an end forever to all our pain and suffering. That is the one end they have. But the means they tell of achieving this end, only the means differ. So like other branches of philosophy, Sankhya also has this one end in view, that how to remove all our pain and suffering forever and ever and ever. So it gives us the knowledge of the self or the Purusha. And Sankhya says that if we can attain the knowledge of Purusha, then we will be rid of all pain and suffering. Just like Vedanta says that the knowledge of Brahman will eradicate all our sorrows. So the knowledge of the self which Sankhya puts forward is clearly higher than given by other systems of Indian philosophy, excepting perhaps the Vedanta. Because it is a slow growth, you see. We slowly grow from one to another till we come to the Vedanta. Of course, other philosophical system will put their philosophy above everything else, but we are Vedantins. So we say that all these lead to the highest knowledge. That's all we can say. It is not fair also to say which is the highest philosophy and which is the lowest. Actually, the one which suits us best is the highest for us. So this is the thing. The thing is, the Sankhya philosophy is very important and very, very deep. That is all that I want to say. And as regarding metaphysics, we have already seen, you already know the meaning. Metaphysics is the branch of philosophy that examines the fundamental nature of reality. Fundamental nature. What lies behind all these phenomena? All these are real. Sometimes we can say that those who adopt the realistic attitude, that is called realism, they say that everything is real, no doubt. But what is the ultimate reality? What is the reality behind everything? So that the study of that is called metaphysics. So Sankhya is a metaphysics of dualistic realism. Dualistic realism. Realism, you know, realism says that everything is real. All that we see is real. It is not any illusion or dream or any such thing. So realism say that everything is real, and dualistic. Dualistic means Sankhya admits of only two ultimate realities. We have studied a little of the Nyaya and Vaisheshika systems. Now Nyaya and Vaisheshika admit the ultimate reality of many entities, atoms, minds, souls. So according to Nyaya, we have seen that atoms are also the ultimate reality. Mind is also the ultimate reality. Souls are also the ultimate reality. But Sankhya reduces all this to two. Two only. Prakriti and Purusha. Sankhya says there are only two ultimate realities. Not so many. And again, Vedanta reduces this to one. Actually, it cannot say one also, because one can only be there when two is there. So Vedanta says that only Brahman is real. Brahman is the only ultimate reality. So anyway, we are studying Sankhya now, so we will concentrate on that. So Sankhya admits of two kinds of ultimate realities, spirit and matter. Spirit is Purusha and matter is Prakriti. So we will discuss what the nature of Purusha and Prakriti is, and when discussing that, also the topic of gunas will come, because gunas is the constituent matter of Prakriti. Gunas is not the quality of Prakriti, mind you. Like a red rose, when we say the rose is red, the red is a quality of Prakriti, quality of the rose. But gunas are not the quality of Prakriti. Gunas are the constituent matter, like the petals of a rose. These are not the qualities of a rose. The rose is made up of its petals. Similarly, Prakriti is made up of the gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. So anyway, we will come to all that later. So today what we will see is the Sankhya metaphysics. Now I'll just show you some images so that you can be clear. Let me share. So here you can see what we have discussed today. Kapila is the founder of the Sankhya Sutras. The book is written there. Kapila's disciple was Asuri. Asuri's disciples was Panchashika, and later came Ishwara Krishna. And Ishwara Krishna's Sankhya Karika is what is studied nowadays. So we have already discussed that Sankhya means discrimination and also perfect knowledge. So it is the philosophy in which we have such knowledge, which allows us to gain such knowledge. Therefore, Sankhya is knowledge of the self through right discrimination. And Sankhya admits of only two kinds of ultimate realities, matter and spirit, or Prakriti and Purusha. So now we will study this philosophy under the following headings. These are the headings. First, the metaphysics. Secondly, pramana, or the theory of knowledge. Third is the doctrine of liberation. According to Sankhya, what is liberation? And fourthly, what does Sankhya have to say about God? So these are the headings. So we will start with metaphysics, and today we will discuss this theory of causation, this one. This is a very important part of the Sankhya philosophy. And in this theory of causation, Sankhya agrees with Vedanta. This we should remember. So when we study this theory of causation, we should know that Vedanta also has the same view as that of Sankhya. Okay. Now, let us start the theory of causation. At first, it may seem a little difficult, but as we proceed, it will become more simple. Now, the Sankhya theory of the ultimate reality of the universe, especially its doctrine of Prakriti, rests mainly on its theory of causation. Theory of causation, which is known as Satkaryavada. Satkaryavada. Vada means doctrine. Like Advaita Vada, the doctrine of Advaita. Vishishtadvaita Vada, the doctrine of Vishishtadvaita, or qualified non-dualism. So this is Satkaryavada, or the doctrine of Satkarya. Sat, you know, Sat means true. Pure being or existence, Sat. And Karya is the effect. Karya is the effect. So, Satkaryavada says that something which exists, which is Sat, cannot originate from Asat, cannot originate from non-existence. Existence cannot originate from non-existence. This is what Satkaryavada states, but it is a very elaborate theory, so we will discuss it in a little detail because it is very important. So what is Satkaryavada? Satkaryavada is a theory as to the relation of an effect to its material cause. Material cause, mind you. See, these terms you have to remember. Efficient cause and material cause. When a potter makes a pot, he makes a pot out of clay. Clay is the material cause. But if you leave some clay, automatically it will not form a pot. Someone has to do that. So the potter who does that, he is the efficient cause. Now this house is made up of wood. So wood is the material cause of this house. Now the theory of Satkaryavada tells us, it examines us, what is the relation between this house and its material cause. What is the relation between wood and this house? A metal bridge. A bridge is made up of metal. Now, what is the relation between the metal and the bridge? A cloth is made up of threads. What is the relation between the thread and the cloth? So, this is what Satkaryavada examines. This is what the theory of causation in the Sankhya philosophy examines. So the specific question discussed here is, does an effect originally exist in the material cause prior to its production? This is the thing. Does the effect exist in the cause before its production? Did this house exist in the wood from which it is formed before it was built? This is the question. Now we have made some cloth from the threads. So the question is, did this cloth exist in the thread before its production? This is the question. So it is a very important question because the whole philosophy of Sankhya rests on the answer to this question. As we will proceed, you will know. So Sankhya says, in contradiction to Bauddhas and Nyaya Vaisheshikas, see, Bauddhas and Nyaya Vaisheshikas says that the cause does not inhere in the effect before its production. They say that when we produce cloth from a thread, Bauddhas and Nyaya Vaisheshikas say that the cloth did not exist in the thread before its production. So according to them, the effect cannot be said to exist before it is produced by some cause. Now let us see the arguments of the Bauddhas and Nyaya Vaisheshikas. Then we will see how Sankhya answers these arguments. So the most beautiful thing about these arguments is that when we read one view, we feel that it is so logical, it cannot be contradicted. So when we read the views of the Bauddhas and the Nyaya Vaisheshikas, we may feel that, oh, what wonderful arguments, how can these be contradicted? But when we see how Sankhya and Vedanta answers them, that is also wonderful. It is simply amazing. See how deep these philosophers have gone. So first of all, let us study the opposite view of the Bauddhas and the Nyaya Vaisheshikas, who say that the effect cannot be said to exist before it is produced by some cause. If a thread produced cloth, cloth did not exist in the thread before. How do they justify this view? First of all, they say that if the effect already existed in the cause prior to its production, there is no sense in our speaking of it as being caused or produced in any way. If they say that if you say that the cloth already was in the thread, then why produce anything? Why do you produce the cloth? It is already there in the thread. So when you say that it already exists in the thread, why produce the cloth at all? It makes no sense. This is one argument. The second argument is, we cannot explain why the activity of any efficient cause is necessary for the production of the effect. If the pot already existed in the clay, why should the potter exert himself? He can simply take up some clay and give us that clay. He can tell us, oh, the pot exists in the clay, just go home and put something there. So this is the view of the Bauddhas, and they say that if the effect was already in the material cause, it would logically follow that the effect is indistinguishable from the cause. If you say that the pot exists in the clay, then what is there to distinguish the pot and the clay? Then they are the same. If the clay already contains the pot, what is there to distinguish them? So this is the third argument. And they say that if the effect is indistinguishable from the cause, we should use the same name for both the pot and the clay, and also that the same purpose would be served by a pot and a lump of clay. If the pot already exists in the clay, why call them differently? Call them both pot. And go home and take the clay, and you put some milk and water in there and you see what happens. So they say that it is impossible that the pot existed in the clay before it was formed. That is the argument. And it seems very logical to us. Yes, they are correct in one way. But how Sankhya answers this is very interesting. So this theory of the Bauddhas and the Nyaya Vaisheshikas, that the effect does not exist in the material cause prior to its production, is known as asatkaryavada. Asatkaryavada. The view that the karya or the effect is asat or non-existent before its production. This is the view of the Bauddhas and the Sankhya, the Bauddhas and the Nyaya Vaisheshika philosophers. So let us see how Sankhya and Vedanta answer them. They say that the effect exists in the material cause even before it is produced. The clay, the pot exists in the clay already before the pot is produced. Okay, now what are the arguments of Sankhya? Let us see. First argument is, if the pot or the effect was really non-existent in the cause or the clay, then no amount of effort on the part of any agent could bring it into existence. They say that if the pot was not in the clay, then no effort could bring out the pot from the clay. For example, if anybody says, convert sugar to salt. If I say, convert sugar to salt, can we do that? Nobody can do that. Because sugar is not there in the salt from the beginning. So when something is not, if I say convert blue color into red color, can anybody do that? Nobody can do that. Because red is not there in the blue. So you cannot do that conversion. So Sankhya says that if the pot was not there in the clay, then no amount of work could bring about that pot. That is the main thing. If I say, convert this pair of glasses into a pot, can it be done? It cannot be done. Because the pot does not exist here in the first place. It exists only in the clay. So they say first argument is that if the pot was not in the clay, then no potter in the world could convert that clay into a pot. This is the first argument. So this says that the activity of efficient causes like the potter and all is necessary to manifest the effect which was already there in the clay. When we plant a seed in the ground, slowly the tree comes up from the seed. Does the same thing happen when we plant a stone? Can a tree come out of a stone? No. It can come out of a seed only because it existed in the seed from before. And when we water it and when it gets the minerals from the soil, that effect is just manifested. But it was there. This is the first argument. Second argument, they say that there is an invariable relation between a cause and its effect. And the effect can only be produced from a cause with which it is related. If there is no relation, no effect can be produced. But it cannot be related to something which does not exist at all. Let me put this point again. There is an invariable relation between the clay and the pot. We cannot deny that. There is a relation between cause and effect. Relation, how can anything be related to something which does not exist? If I say that the pot did not exist in the clay, then how can the clay be related to the pot? But we cannot deny that the cause is always related to the effect. So Sankhya says, if you say that the pot was not there in the clay before, then you say that the clay is not related to the pot in any way. But that is not possible because cause and effect are always related. So if you say that the clay was not present at all, the pot was not present at all in the clay, then how can the pot and the clay be related? In order to relate to something, that something must exist first. So we say that the pot already existed in the clay before it was manifested. This is the third point. This is the second point. Now come to the third point. They say that we see that only certain effects can be produced from certain causes. Like curd can be got out only from milk. If I give you some honey and tell you make curd out of it, is it possible? No. It is not possible because only milk can produce curd. If this would not have been true, any effect could be produced from any cause. Potter says that only clay can produce pots. But if this was not true, then the potter could have produced pots from anything. We could have given some milk to the potter and said that, oh, make some pots out of that. But that would not have been possible, because the pot does not exist in the milk. But it exists in the clay. That is why only clay can produce a pot and not any other thing. This is another argument. And another argument is that if the effect be really non-existent in the cause, then we have to say that when it is produced, something which is non-existence comes into existence. Just try to understand this. From asat, sat cannot come. From non-existence, something which exists cannot come. If somebody tells us that he has made this pair of glasses from vacuum, shall we believe him? We know that it cannot be true. Vacuum cannot produce anything. Non-existence cannot produce anything which is existent. So Sankhya says, if you say that the pot did not exist in the clay, then when the pot is manufactured, something is coming out of nothing. Something is coming out of nothing. If it did not exist before, how did it manifest itself? If we see a tree, we know there must have been a seed. Without a seed, how can the tree come? It is impossible. So, if the tree did not exist in the seed, then actually we will be saying that the tree came out of nothing, which is nonsense. So, these are very subtle arguments. I know that immediately it may not be clear, but if we reflect upon this, slowly it will become clear, and even if you don't remember it, there is no problem. But this theory of Satkaryavada is very important, and even if we can understand a little of these arguments and remember it only a little, that will be sufficient for our purpose. So the Sankhya says that the effect and the cause are the explicit and implicit states of the same substance. A cloth is not really different from the threads of which it is made. A statue, if it is made up of a stone, it is actually not different from the stone. Only a new shape and form have been given to the stone. So when the form changes, we call it statue. But actually, it is just the stone. So the conclusion drawn by the Sankhya from all this is that the effect exists in the material cause even before its production. The cloth exists in the thread even before its production. But the cloth does not exist everywhere. The cloth does not exist in the spectacles. और इन दिस फोन, इट एग्जिस्ट ओनली इन इट्स कॉज, दिस वी शुड रिमेम्बर. द क्लॉथ एग्जिस्ट ओनली इन इट्स मटीरियल कॉज, द पॉट एग्जिस्ट ओनली इन द क्ले, अ मेटल ब्रिज एग्जिस्ट ओनली इन द मेटल, दिस वी शुड रिमेम्बर. सो दिस इज द थ्योरी ऑफ सत्कार्यवाद, द व्यू दैट the effect is existent before its production. This is very important because the whole theory of Sankhya, the metaphysics of Sankhya, the evolution from the Prakriti is based upon this theory, the theory of Satkaryavada. Now, this theory of Sankhya has two different forms. One is Parinamavada. Parinama means change. And other is Vivartavada. Vivartavada means only appearance. This is where Sankhya differs from Vedanta. Parinamavada, or the theory of real change, says that when an effect is produced, there is a real transformation of the cause into the effect. Like they say that Prakriti has actually transformed itself into all these things, all the universe. But Vedanta says that the ultimate cause of the world, which is Brahman, Vedanta supports Vivartavada, or the theory of apparent change. Vedanta says Brahman seems to change into this world, but actually it does not change. It is only an appearance. So this Satkaryavada has two forms, Parinamavada, which says that the Prakriti actually transforms itself into this world which is very much real, and Vedanta says that it seems that Brahman becomes this world, but actually there is no change in Brahman. This is called Vivartavada. So, this is the theory of Satkaryavada in short. From that, we will slowly go to the Prakriti and the Gunas, and then we will see that how, according to Sankhya, this whole universe, this whole of nature has evolved from Prakriti. Just a very short, nothing very detailed, but today Satkaryavada I discussed in detail, one because it is very important, and I found these arguments to be very interesting. So this joy of knowledge, that also I wanted to convey. So I hope that instead of conveying, I have not confused everybody completely. But as we keep on hearing this, slowly, slowly, it will become clear. So we need not remember all the details, but the fundamental characteristics of these things, Prakriti, Gunas and Purusha, those are important. Those we will slowly discuss, and we will discuss it many, many times in future also when we discuss the scriptures. So automatically, we will be able to understand a lot about them. So today I think we can end here. Next time we will go to Prakriti and the Gunas. What is the nature of Prakriti and how Gunas, the Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, how they are related to Prakriti. Let us end here then. ओम शांति 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 हरि ओम तत्सत श्री राम कृष्णार्पणमस्तु।